assignment. That's my assignment too. This is my other assignment. Very familiar passage of scripture, just want to revisit it one more time or another time. You may have me visit it again. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14 and 15. 1 John chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. Version of 1 John chapter 5 verse 14 and 15 reads as such. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Verse 15. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we have asked of him. Let's pray. Most gracious and all-wise Father, here I am again. I need you more than silver and gold. I need you to be with me and speak to me and speak through me. As I speak to this your people, send fresh manna from on high. God, I pray, God, you will be with me, speak through me. I pray you open the ears of the hearts of the receivers, and that your word will fall on good and fertile ground, and that it may produce fruit in days to come. God, I pray in the name of Jesus, you keep me humble, obedient, submissive, and sensitive to your spirit and your spirit alone. God, I pray that you will let the words of my mouth, oh God, the meditation of my heart, my words and my thoughts, be your words and your thoughts, oh Lord, my strength and my redeemer. These blessings we ask in Jesus' name we pray and we thank you. Amen. You be seated in the presence of the Lord. Allow me to read it once again. Verse 14 of this here, chapter 1 John. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Verse 15, if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. I want to talk the time that we share together, my brothers and sisters, praying his will. Praying his will. It is common and natural in the natural to pray some things we feel we ought to pray. But in the text, John tells his audience how we ought to pray. He starts off, now this is the confidence that we have in him. Now, presently, this is a confidence that we have in him. The word confidence in the text means the trust that we have in him. You and I have to have some confidence in the God of our salvation. In the God of whom we serve. We must have some confidence or some trust or some belief in whom we serve. So Paul is saying, and it's inclusive, because he includes himself. Now this is a confidence that we have in him. He's including himself to tell the church that we need confidence. But the word confidence also not only means trust, belief, it also means boldness. You remember in the book of Hebrews where the Bible says, let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we may find help in a time of need. We must come boldly to him with our requests. When we know that we have eternal life, needless to say, we can go before the Lord with confidence. When you and I know that we are with God, and we truly walking with God and walking for God, we have the assurance or the boldness or the confidence or the trust or the belief in whom we're talking to. Give you an analogy here. If you go on your job and your supervisor or your manager asks you to do a task, now watch this, they have confidence in you that you can complete the task. Amen. They are bold to tell you, number one. Number two, they trust you won't do it. Number three, they trust you won't do it correctly. And so we go to God and believe in that he's going to do it. He's going to do it right. And he's going to do it correctly. And knowing that he is God and God all by himself, there is no need to doubt what we talked to him about. However, the second part of verse number 14 says this. That if we ask anything according to his will, I want to use the Greek construction of the word if today. Since we ask anything according to his will, the word according to means agreement. It also means harmony with him. You and I have got to have a strong relationship with whom we serve. And when we have a strong relationship with whom we serve, we are in agreement with him and we are in harmony with him. Watch this. How can two walk together unless they what? Because when there is disharmony there, there can be no togetherness. There can be no unification, and when there's no unity and harmony there, there can be no blessings that will befall us because we're not in harmony. So Paul, so rather John here tells the audience, the hearers, that you and I have got to be in agreement and in harmony, watch this, according to his will. The question, the next question in this first, the second part of the text is, what is his will? I'm glad you asked me. His will is what you have in your hand. Well, some people got devices. I'll go to the scripture. You got scripture there. You got scripture there. So it's whatever you got, what you got in your hand, which is the Bible. It is God's will. And what John is telling the people, that you and I, he is in harmony, he's in agreement. When we pray, his will. And I want to let you know that the devil does not want you and I to pray his will. And I go further, the devil does not want us to pray his word. All right. going to pray the word and start to pray the words off the pages of the Bible, God starts to move. Now, wait a minute, because I don't want to hit somebody in the head. He was like, wait a minute. You done prayed the word. You done told scripture, but nothing happened yet. You know the word he just said, yet. And I want to say this to you, brothers and sisters. He says, we have a covenant. When we pray the word of God, the will of God, God will answer my prayer. I don't care to hear what happens right now, but God's word will not return unto him void. And the word void, that the word will not return to him empty. It will accomplish that with itself. The devil is a liar. When we, the church of God, start to pray the word of God, God will start to reveal himself. God will start to manifest himself. God will start to move his people. God will start to work things out.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. Indeed, we should fear to pray. Watch this. Listen to this. Oh, we should fear to pray for anything that is not according to his will. What God is saying, we ought to be afraid of praying for anything outside of the scripture. And when there's a fear there, or there's a fear there, that, no, God, I want to pray your will. I want to pray your word. I don't want to pray anything outside of your will. Perhaps somebody may say, but how can I know the will of God in a general way? The answer is that God's will is revealed to us, watch this, in sacred scripture. This book is sacred. This book is sacred. Any other book you read is not sacred, but this is sacred. This is a sacred book. This is sacred scripture. This is sacred words of God. So we ought to pray scripture, and we should study the word in order that we might know better what God's will is, and how we can pray more. Watch this, how we can pray more intelligently. Can I just share something with you all? We got to take these words on this page or pages and start praying. And I'm going to tell you something. When you start praying the words off the scripture, off the page of the Bible, you're in for a fight. You're in for a fight. And I want to ask you a question. How tough are you? I'm saying it again. How tough are you? And the reason why I ask this question is because the devil is better fighting us tooth and nail. And if we're not tough, or if we're not strong, we're going to be tricked and hoodwinked and bamboozled out of what God has for us. God has great and mighty and wonderful things for we, the people of God. How tough are we? We need to practice these things that pleases him. And that we must seek God like never before. We need to go after God, and he cannot, and I cannot let nothing, nobody stop us from going after God. Romans 8 says this, when Paul talks to the church at Rome, he says, what shall separate us from the love of God? He says, tribulation, persecution, famine, nakedness, perilous war. And all these things. He said, death, heights, or any other creature. Watch this. They shall not separate me from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ our Lord. We're in for a fight of our life spiritually. You and I have got to work it out. I don't know why I keep telling people all of a sudden, this. I guess I've been talking about working out your own soul salvation. I've been telling people, work it out.
All right.
Work it out.
Right.
You and I have got to work it out.
Right.
We got to work it out like never before. Work it out.
Yes.
We got to work this out.
Yeah.
We got to be strong.
Yeah.
We got to be, strong. Strong in the Lord Jesus Christ. Many people, I was reading we're in the last days.
Yes, we are.
I'm going to show you the reason why. In the book of Thessalonians, it says, in the last days, there shall be a great falling away.
Yes.
There are many who are falling away from the faith.
Yes.
I'm using another word. Many people are defecting from the faith.
Wow. All right, man.
And they're defecting to the point where they just don't care no more. But I want to serve you some devil. There, God has got a remnant.
Yes.
He's got a remnant that will hold on, hold out, endure to the end. He has a remnant.
Yes.
Right.
And before I go to verse 15, we have got to pray scripture. We're in the end time. We're in the last days. The Bible is fulfilling itself.
Yes.
And if God doesn't soon return, he's going to repent that he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah.
Well.
He's on his way back.
Yes.
God is tired of what's going on in this world. People who said they were with God have defected from the faith. And watch this. What's really sad is people who've been with God for 20, 30 years have now defected from the faith. And if you and I have really got God and really got the full hope on God, don't you let nobody stop your hope. I'm going to say it, personal experience. Hope it helps somebody. The devil knows, I said, he knows his time is short.
Yes, sir.
And he's going to try everything he can to distract us,
yes,
to stop us,
yes,
make us turn around,
yes,
make us give up.
Yes.
And I said it before. And even though I'm a pastor, the Star Batman Baptist Pentecostal Church, and all that stuff, I'm not exempt.
Amen.
And I'm telling you something, God, the devil knows what gets us.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
The devil knows what gets us.
Uh-huh.
And I'm gonna go into detail, but the devil will try to. And he knows what gets you. He knows exactly what gets you. And I'm going to say something, how he tried to get me. And I'm going to tell you how he didn't get me. He will throw some good things in the past. I'll say it like this and around that way. He will throw some good things in your way and have you gone into depression. And I'll tell you how I didn't go for that. I want to note. When you get a relationship with God, you get in this, you know this, and you know the tricks of the enemy. Because if I go to Matthew chapter 4, Jesus was in the wilderness. Watch this, to be tempted of the devil. And that's why it's important that you and I know scripture. That's why it is very vitally important that we get in scripture and know scripture, because we're in a battle.
Yes.
And we're where it is because he gets in your mind. I tell you, when he gets to the mind, he's got the person. And I went to Philippians. Have the mind of Christ. When you have the mind of Christ, you don't go into depression. Come on, somebody. When in the Corinthians, let this mind be in you which is also in Christ Jesus. When you let this mind be in you which is also in Christ Jesus, you don't go into depression.
All right.
When you go into other part of Corinthians, he says, casting down every imagination that they exalt itself against God. You and I have got to rebuke those thoughts that are not of God. They're gonna come, and sometimes they're gonna come with a double force. And how we handle it is very important. You and I have got to use the Bible to defeat the devil. And if Jesus did it, we can do it. And if it worked for Jesus, it'll work for us. John is trying to get the church to realize that you got to know the Bible, you got to know the Word, and when you start praying the Word, God will start to move on your behalf. Now, notice the text doesn't say when He's going to move. He doesn't say He's going to move. But catch verse 15. Now, I'm coming home. Before I go to 15, he said this. Because I almost forgot this little part that's very important, verse 14. Three words. He said, He hears us. Let me get my head up just for, give me 2 minutes here. He says, He hears us. So when we start to pray the Bible, God hears us. He hears, I got to say it again, because somebody didn't get it. When we pray the scripture, God hears us. I can say it again. When we pray scripture, God hears us. One more time. When we pray scripture, God hears us. Can I go a little further with this verse? And I'm going to verse 15. When he uses the word us, he means all of us. When all of us pray, the will of God, the scripture, God hears us. Watch this. He could have said he hears Messiah. Hallelujah. I like God. God said, no, because God said just in his order to be picking on her. And everybody else would be left out. But God said, He hears us. And He's every last one of us. It means it's inclusive of all of us. God hears us. You ought to tell your neighbor, thank you, Jesus. I don't do this often, but you need to tell your neighbor, neighbor,
neighbor.
God hears us. Verse 15 and says the same thing. He ends verse 14. He said, and he hears us. Oh my. He hears us. And whatever we ask, according to his will, watch this, we know. Oh my goodness. We know that we have the petition, the request, the supplication that we have asked of him. And literally is opposing what he's really saying. Now that we've prayed the scripture and we know he hears us and we send our request up to him, our supplication up to him, we know he will answer.
Yeah.
And we know that he will answer.
Right.
And we know that he will answer our request and our supplication. I can reiterate, I don't know when he's going to do it. I don't know when he's going to answer, but I'm still going to trust him while I wait on him, because my request shall be granted. There's another word. Thank you, Holy Ghost. The word, there's another word. Just comes to mind that he will approve. Okay, those who work in the financial institution, who work in the loan department, when you apply for a loan, you fill out the application, you put all your information in, all that stuff, and then they come back to you and tell you whether you will approve or deny. I want, as I'm closing, I want to tell you, my brothers and my sisters, when we pray the word of God and knowing he hears us and knowing he's going to answer our requests, we've been approved. And let me go back to the loan part for a moment. I just do them. And when you are approved, watch this, nobody can deny the approval except you. Even the institution can't deny you because you've already been approved. Only you can deny your approval. And I said to say this, when you've been approved by God, can nobody change the approval but you. Because God is not going to reverse what he already told you he's going to do. Am I in the Bible? Because in Numbers chapter 23, he says, and I can't reverse it. I can't put it in replay. It's already established. And since you've been approved and established, can nobody do anything but you. The Lord bless you, because he's done. And I'm done too. The Lord bless you.